So I'm so happy to be part of this OWASP conference today. So the topic is topic which we myself and others would be presenting is demystifying the digital pandemic. Okay, so we all are going through a pandemic now, which is still not over yet, and with a new variant of the virus evolving every few months. So now let's take a look at how a parallel pandemic is happening at the same time in the digital world. So let's get started. So in today's session, we'll be mostly covering about what infomania is and some of the misinformation trends or false information trends that we have to encounter, and types of information disorders, social engineering attack strategies, and how we can tackle this menace of infodemic to in our capacity. So the coronavirus disease emerged towards the late 2019, and after that, immediately itself on January 2020, the World Health Organization declared it as a public health emergency of international concern, and also termed it as a worst pandemic that the world has seen so far since the Spanish flu in 1918. So besides the rising number of cases and fatalities, the outbreak also affected the employment and also the economies all over the world. And at this time, billions of people were isolated at their homes to contain this infection. And also this created an uncertainty, as an atmosphere of uncertainty, which resulted in anxiety and panic, as we know. When there is an uncertainty, there will be a situation of anxiety and panic. As a result of this lockdown and all, people started moving online, whether it is for their work, education, or even entertainment. The communications that would have mostly that would have happened in the physical world started shifting online. So social media was one of the main medium of communication, for medium of reaching out to others all over the world. So in social media, we know anybody and everybody can create content, and it will get a very wide reach in seconds. So this created an information. So anybody can post anything which is not reviewed, which is not fact-checked, that sort, and the spread is in real time. So this resulted in something called an information pollution. So when there is too much of information, and when it is passed from passed on from one hand to another, we know it is prone to forgery. It is prone to mixing up with false information, people's personal opinions, and everything. So this resulted in an information pollution. And finally, this catapulted as a digital pandemic, or as per the term of WHO, it is called infodemic. So in the words of the WHO director, Dr. Tedros, he says that we are not just fighting an epidemic, but we are fighting an infodemic. So this infodemic consists of all sorts of misinformation, rumors, conspiracy theories, and everything that is circulating day by day. And the definition of infodemic is that a large volume of information information is out there associated with one specific topic, and its growth is almost exponentially in a short period of time, mainly due to a specific incident that has happened, like the COVID-19 pandemic. So we have a situation where there is a lot of information that is being produced and shared out to every corner of the world, reaching billions of people. But how much of that information is true, is accurate? Just some of it. So that is the scenario. And the spread of digital virus, this virtual virus, which which is the infodemic, happened because of the increasing, because once, because of the lockdown, people got accustomed to the online lifestyle. So increase in digital screen time, that is whether for news, entertainment or social media. And also the main source of main medium of information consumption was digital in the form of video, audio, memes, text messages, etc. So in the current digital age, we face something called infomania. As per Wikipedia, it is the debilitating state of information overload, which is caused by the combination of a backlog of information to process and continuous interruptions from technologies like phones, instant messaging, and email. So we know that now we almost we all have this urge to constantly be up to date. By being up to date, I do not mean only checking the news, but there are a lot of updates that is coming in the form of social media notifications, messages, then the emails that we receive, etc. So this obsessive need or urge to constantly check and keep ourselves updated with information is what we call infomania. And at this time, we process about 3 to 5 times more information compared to the past decade. And when we are unable to check for the constant update, we experience something called FOMO, that is fear of missing out. And as a result of this, there is continuous partial attention. That is a term coined by Linda Stone of Microsoft. By this, it means we are giving our focus to different things, to more than one thing, but only at a superficial level. So the current information explosion actually demands us to distracts us and pulls our focus to multiple things, but our brain can focus only on one thing properly at a time. So we are giving only a superficial level of focus or attention to multiple sources of information. So by information, we know it is a mix of the facts, which might be scientifically backed, or some happenings at a location. All those comes under information. Now, misinformation is false information, but it is usually spread without a bad intention. Somebody who is spreading that information do not have any intention to hurt someone, but in an innocent way, this false information is being spread. But in the case of disinformation, it is the intentional spreading of false information. I know that something is this information is wrong. It can cause harm to somebody if they act upon it, but still I'm sending. That is called disinformation. So in this infodemic, it is a total mix of this information, misinformation, and disinformation. And when making decisions or consuming information, we have certain biases. Inherently, human beings are biased, we all know. But when consuming information, we have certain confirmation bias. That is, we have a set of beliefs and knowledge within ourselves, and we do not wish that somebody will prove us wrong. So we tend to focus on the information and or sources of information that reinforces our set of beliefs. So here you can see there is a whole set of beliefs at our side, and there are certain facts and evidences, but a small portion of that seems to reinforce our beliefs. So the evidence we tend to believe are those that reinforces our beliefs, and there is the whole lot of evidence that lies outside that we tend to ignore them, and because it creates a friction when something is contradicting our beliefs. That in order to avoid that, we tend to ignore that. This is called cognitive dissonance, and people can be some people can be extremely biased, not moving an inch from their beliefs. Some people, have a pretty good growth mindset, who are ready to learn, unlearn, and relearn. But whatever we say, there is a small pinch of bias in everybody. So some of the motives behind creating this, creating and propagating this disinformation are like monetary gain. During this pandemic time also, there were many fake or fraudulent sites that were created in the name of COVID and asking for donations or in the name of charity, etc. So the fraudsters might have the intention of monetary gain, or sometimes it can be a political gain. That is, one political party may want to degrade, or it's their win when the other one is tarnished, other one is tarnished, or in a bad image. So it can be political gain, spreading disinformation about the opposition party. Or some people may feel like, okay, let me see to what extent this can go, this can spread. So that is more of a psychological factor, and some may feel like experimenting with that. So these are some of the general intentions behind spreading misinformation. Spreading disinformation, yeah. And some of this misinformation or false information trends that we see, especially in this pandemic time. One is the closed messaging apps, or like WhatsApp. Closed messaging groups in apps are spaces where misinformation and conspiracy theories are being shared. In closed messaging groups, we have our close friends or the close relatives or family members. So when we receive some information, we share them with our near and dear ones. So in such groups, there is more of a safety feeling that we can share this information irrespective of whether that is true or not. We do not hesitate, or we do not think twice before sharing to such groups. And it was found that such groups were the toppers in spreading misinformation during the pandemic times. And altered or fake content is used as very highly effective tactic. When an email, when a fake email is forged with logos or pictures or names of genuine authorities, credible authorities, then the chance of people getting tricked into that is more. So such altered content were used for propagating misinformation. And next one is misinformation that is spread in the form of hate speech, memes against different sections, and also it widens existing divisions such as race, etc. So these hate speech and memes have humor. Hate speech also have emotionally charged content. So when such information were presented in the form of hate speech and memes, in a very subtle way, it was able to propagate. Okay, so that was a concern. That was a concern, and it is not what to say. It is difficult to find also when such misinformation are propagated in a subtle way in hate speech and memes. It is pretty much difficult to find out also. Then visual and video content are more influential and more difficult to monitor than textual content. One example is this documentary style video that is named Plandemic, in which a lady who is portraying herself as an established a doctor, she was speaking about this pandemic being a planned one by some groups with some hidden intentions. And stuff. And she was also speaking against vaccination. It was a lot of misleading content, but this did many rounds in social media before social media like Facebook were able to find this, that it is misleading content and take it down because it's a visual content and it is difficult for difficult to find out quickly. So people who watch this video tend to believe at a time of uncertainty, they tend to believe this, and out of their anxious situation, they tend to believe this. And if they act upon it, this it creates a wrong, I mean, worse situation, right? And next one was conspiracy theories spilled to the mainstream during COVID-19 certainty. One among that is about 5G, relation between 5G and COVID-19. And many Facebook groups also were formed around these conversations. And street violence were also happening, and that too in places where 5G was not even existing. So that was one sad side of this conspiracy theories. So why this conspiracy theories work? Because they provide the comfort of an explanation at a time of uncertainty and anxiety. Next, coming to the type of information disorders, in what all ways the information can be forged? They are imposter content, fabricated content, false context, manipulated content, satire or parody, and then misleading content. So regarding misleading content, we also already saw regarding the example, the documentary called Plantemic. And satire or parody, it can be humorous at a particular context. But what happens when it is shared out of the context and it is you know, it is passed on from hands to hands, it is shared so many times so that it loses the root context entirely, and when it reaches someone, someone may misinterpret that, and it can convey totally opposite or a different perspective to the audience. Then imposter content is impersonation of genuine sources, like I already said, the credible organizations like UN or WHO or the Ministry of Health at your nation can be forged. They are the genuine sources. So posing as them and then propagating your disinformation and disinformation agenda was prevalent in the COVID-19 times. So that is imposter content. Next is fabricated content. That is totally false content that is spun out of thin air. An example is this text message where it is saying that UK government has issued a payment of £458 to all residents as part of its promise to battle COVID-19. So this is very false, and this link might redirect the audience to some fraudulent website also. So that is fabricated content. Then comes false context. The information is factually correct, factually accurate, but it is shared under a false context, contextual information. This picture was widely shared during the Nepal earthquake that happened in 2015. But then, and it is emotionally appealing to audience, a brother and a sister, the brother is consoling the sister and stuff. So it was gaining a lot of audience and reach. But actually this picture was taken in Vietnam in 2007. And under a false context, this picture was being shared. Next comes manipulated content. So, slight distortion or tweaking of genuine information or image to convey a different, entirely different message to the audience. So, one example is here we can say how we saw it. We saw it like this, but this is how it really happened. A gun is pointed and is giving water, maybe. But some other people, to some other people, it was portrayed in this way. So that is the power of manipulation. Now we may think like, okay, what is the big deal about misinformation? We get a wrong information. It's okay that we don't act on it. We can just ignore it. But what about, you know, okay, we use our critical thinking abilities to check it. And if at all we find it suspicious, we can ignore it. Yes, that is true. But what about people who do not have as much media or digital literacy as maybe us, but they are also getting such fake information. They also have smartphones and devices. So here is an article that was published by WHO, where it says, acting on the wrong information can kill. In the first 3 months of 2020, nearly 6,000 people around the globe were hospitalized because of coronavirus misinformation. It was not because of being infected by COVID, but because of acting on the wrong information related to COVID. So during this period, at least 800 people may have died due to misinformation related to COVID-19, which is very unfortunate. So that is the potential or power of misinformation in misleading people. Then in social media, the misinformation and disinformation campaigns follow this clickbait approach. We all come across clickbaits almost daily. So what is a clickbait? It is used as a marketing or publicity stunt. So in social media, almost everyone, all pages or all businesses want clicks from the users. Even if they are producing substandard content, if it is not for that headline, not for that clickbaity headline, the user will not click and watch it or click and read it. So it is a misrepresentation of the internal content. So what is inside when we click and open the link will not be related to the heading at all sometimes, or sometimes the headline might be tweaked. Even news channels also follow the same trick on the users. So it also follows sensationalist and dramatic wordings, but the content will be misleading. So an example is, leading doctor reveals the number one worst carb you are eating. So we will be curious to know what that is. Okay. So next is cyber crimes and infodemic. So in a situation like this, when there is too much of information overload, and also at the same time, people are looking out for information, how this situation and the crisis of COVID is being capitalized by fraudsters or cyber criminals in carrying out their own vested interest. So cyber threats constantly evolve, we know, by taking advantage of the online behaviors of people and also the trends that is emerging day by day. So the attack vectors are also altered in accordance with these. And as per Interpol, there is a target shift from individuals and small businesses to major corporations, governments, and critical infrastructure in these after this COVID time. Okay, so one of the major strategy that these attackers are using to carry out the cyber attacks is what is called social engineering. It is basically to trick the human mind to divulging sensitive information. And most often it is said to be a low tech approach. There is little or no use of technology there, mostly. So it is a low-tech approach to creating a high impact, to carrying out a high impact cybercrime. So now my co-speaker Adarsh will explain in detail about what social engineering is and what are the various strategies and how we can get the cues of social engineering and stay safe from that. Over to you, Adarsh.
So we already saw that, or Vishma already explained about the crisis capitalization. So the crisis capitalization that has some kind of relationship with the social engineering. That is why I am going to tell you about social engineering. You know, the social engineering is a kind of manipulation of human mind. That means tricking the human mind to steal confidential information. That is one of the main objectives of social engineering attacks. When we talk about the crisis capitalization, as we already hear from Grishma, that during the time of crisis, the cyber criminals are trying to utilize that crisis situation for monetizing or for carrying out their illegal activities. So when it comes to the crisis capitalization, in aligned to the social engineering attacks, the social engineering attacks is one of the common platform in which the cyber criminals are utilizing to perform or to do their crisis capitalization activities. So when we talk about social engineering, as I mentioned before, it is tricking the human mind or getting the confidence of an end user and trying to steal the confidential information. So from the figure, it's quite interesting. Actually, the tagline is, a chain is only as strong as its weakest link, right? Even if we have a very, very big chain which is made up of very strong metal, if at least one link is weak, there is no point to have that strongest chain, right? Because it is useless. Something similar to that, in every security system, the end users are being considered as the weakest link or the vulnerable point. So the social engineering attackers are trying to use that weakness or trying to exploit that weakest link to carry out their illegal activities. Okay, so as I mentioned before, social engineering is nothing but it's a kind of psychological manipulation of human mind and convincing them and getting their confidence and either stealing some confidential information or asking them to do some kind of activity, which in turn helps the cyber criminal to monetize. Okay. Before I'm coming to the various aspects of social engineering, let me try to bring one important point. See, when we look into some major data breaches happened in the past, we can see that there is an involvement of social engineering attacks. That means those kind of attacks or those kind of cyber attacks happened or has been originated from a social engineering attack, let's say phishing. So as you see in the screen, there are different kind of security attacks, starting from the normal web application or the application vulnerabilities, then the stolen credentials. Okay, when we talk about the stolen credentials, the social engineering attack is having an influence or having a role in credential stealing. We will come into it later. Apart from that, there are different kind of attacks like malware, ransomware, phishing, social engineering. I'm trying to convey that social engineering would be considered the most important thing. It's not only in a crisis time, but always it is a threat to the security. Okay, so in social engineering, we are categorizing it into four types. It's a phishing, pretexting, baiting, and tailgating. So phishing, which is the most common one. I think most of you are familiar with phishing attacks. This is a kind of social engineering attacks in which the attackers are using email as a medium to execute their attack. That is a phishing attack. Pretexting is a kind of, pretexting is kind of pretending to be someone else. Let's say I am approaching to a customer and stating that, hey, I am from an IT department. Okay, there is one issue in your system and I want to fix it. So I'm pretending to be someone else and gaining the end user's confidence. And through that, I'm trying to do my bad intention. That is a pretexting. Next is baiting or quid pro quo. It is nothing but it's a kind of offering something and taking something back. That means it's a kind of offering if you click in this link or if you share your email ID, or if you share your SSN or any kind of other information, we are providing a free ticket or a kind of a free, let's say, when we connect it with the COVID time, if you are registering with this link, or if you are donating $10 or something, I'm giving you a free vaccine slot. So anything or any service or anything that is offered to the end user, and then trying to either collect confidential information or influencing the end user to do some kind of bad things in their system. That is called baiting or quid pro quo. The other one is tailgating. You know, the intention of implementing an access control system, it's in relationship with the physical security, right? So in restricted area, definitely it is controlled by any access control system. If an unauthorized user, he doesn't have any authorization or any right to enter into that premise, but he's just piggybacking to an authorized user to get into the restricted area. So that is called tailgating or the piggybacking. As I mentioned before, phishing has a lot of relationship with the crisis capitalization. From the starting of the COVID-19, I mean in the starting of 2020, there is a huge increase, or I would say an exponential increase, in the number of phishing attempts or phishing attacks happened in the cyberspace. In one of the studies, they mentioned that there is an increase of 220% with respect to the phishing attacks in the cyberspace. Even the WHO already published many advisories in terms of the phishing attacks or phishing mails, which is related to the COVID-19 treatment or COVID-19 vaccines or something related to the WHO. So one of the main reasons behind that would be, Pritish already covered that, as a part of the COVID-19 times, we all know that is the most challenging times, not only for one or two countries, it's for the entire globe. It's the most challenging time. Because of the lockdown and other restrictions, a lot of companies, organizations have been migrated to the cyberspace. I would say the COVID-19 would become one of the driving force, one of the catalysts to increase the momentum of digital transformation. So as a result, the traffic in digital space or the presence of businesses and other commodities in the digital space has been increased. At the same time, the cyber criminals or the cyber attackers have got a golden opportunity for them to execute their illegal stuff, because there are a lot of people are in cyberspace. As a result, they would get a lot of victims or a lot of targets to execute their crime. So when it comes to the phishing, it's a kind of, as I mentioned before, it's a social engineering attack. I mean, trying to convince the human mind and steal the confidential information. If the emails are used as the medium for phishing, so a medium for social engineering attacks, that is called phishing. So when we analyze the phishing mails, we would say there are two types of activities or two types of objectives that is having for a phishing mail. One, it may have a kind of a link in which the user is asked to click the link, and the link will navigate the users to some website. Most of the time, that would be a kind of a fake website, and asking the end user to provide some confidential information, either SSN or some kind of financial information like the credit card number or debit card number and so on. So that is a one type. Another type is the drive-by download. That means the email itself is having a kind of attachment. Most of the time, that attachment is already embedded with a kind of Trojan or a kind of a ransomware kind of malware. And once the user downloaded that file to the system or even opened it, definitely the system is being infected, and thereby the attackers can compromise the system. So the ransomware, I just mentioned the term ransomware. Ransomware is nothing but it's a kind of a malware that is encrypting the entire files of the infected system. We saw the WannaCry ransomware attacks hit in the globe on 2017, then the last year, Maze attack. So the ransomware attack is one of the biggest threat, I would say, now the industry or even individually are facing. Okay. So the emails are one of the primary medium for the ransomware spreading. So the phishing, two types of objectives, that is the drive-by download or the clicking lab, the clicking link. And the basic objective is to steal confidential information or compromise the victim system. This is one example of the phishing email. You know, the Costco is one of the famous retailers in the United States. So the mail looks like a kind of originated from Costco, and it is asking the customer to fill some form. Definitely, it would be asking the customer to fill some confidential information, either the customer's social security number or asking them to share their financial information. But then when we look into the source of the mail, I mean, from where the mail has been originated, it's from a kind of manager at cbcbuilding.com. So this is one of the first check that we have to do. From here, it's clear that it is not originated from Costco, because if it is originated from Costco, the mail domain, I mean, the at the rate kind of like the word after the at the rate would be something related to Costco. Let's say at the rate Costco.com, but it's totally different. So that is one of the first factor that we have to check. And here it is very clear that it has been originated from somewhere else, and we can consider it as a red flag. So this part already Grishma covered, because as I mentioned before, during the COVID time, there are a lot of mail circulated across the cyberspace with the theme COVID-19, and they are impersonating the World Health Organization's name and logo and everything, and trying to fool the people, and thereby they are trying to steal confidential information. So there are a lot of advisory messages published from WHO sites in regards. This is another one. It's not just only restricted to the phishing mail. There are a lot of other activities. As I mentioned before, the email. See, if the social engineering attack is using email as a medium, that is called the phishing attack. Similarly, there are many other types. We will look into it in the coming slides. The cyber criminals are using those tactics to steal confidential information. So WHO already published a certain warning related to or warning to their end users or warning to the internet users that beware of these kind of phishing emails or social engineering attacks. Okay, so this is just one example for a demonstration purpose. So here I am trying to tell you how we can identify a phishing email. As I mentioned before, there may be the cyber criminals can use anything. The COVID-19 team or any kind of income tax filing or any kind of medical insurance or a newsletter from your HR department or your CEO, any team they can use. Okay, so this is just one example mail that looks like originated from Facebook. Okay, so then but actually it is not. I will tell you how we can identify it. See, as I mentioned before, just in the Costco example, the mail has been originated from a totally different domain. It's like at the rate S1620565 or something. If it is from Facebook, definitely the mail domain would be something like facebook.com or a facebookmail.com. So that is the first check, or that is the first red flag. Or I can use a different name, it's called phishing indicators or indicators of phishing. So that is the first indicator. Second, the most of the time, the legitimate mails are addressing their customers rather than a general salutation. If we are getting a mail from our banking department or a bank, definitely it will address us, dear Adarsh or dear Grishma or whatever. So that is the second part. Third one, the legitimate mails, definitely it is properly drafted without any grammar mistake or any spelling mistake. A poorly drafted email should be to identify whether that is a genuine one or a phishing one. Then the other one is you can see one button. There may be some link or a button be available in the email. So before clicking that, if we hover our mouse on top of that button or a link, we can see to which website actually it is navigating. From this example, it's clear that it is navigating to icpnet.pl. It's a totally different one. So Facebook never send an email with a hyperlink or a button to navigate to a totally different site. If it is something to Facebook, definitely it will reach or it will navigate us to facebook.com or any kind of subdomain associated with facebook.com. So these are the main points or main red flags or phishing agent, phishing indicators that we need to check once we received an email. Okay. So next, let me show you one example. Okay. See, this is our Facebook login page, right? So how we can identify it's a genuine Facebook login page? We can see that it's facebook.com, it's HTTPS, the Facebook logo is there, username and password is there, and look and feel is exactly look like Facebook. It's a genuine one. That's true. Now I'm going to show you one phishing website. Nowadays, it's very easy to create this kind of website. Logo is same. The looks, the color theme, the wordings are almost similar. I would say 99% is similar. When we look into the URL, it's HTTPS, there is Facebook.com. But stop there. I can see the Facebook.com here. But is that a real domain? No. You can see that the securitytech.xy is that. Okay, securitytech.xy is that. That is a real domain. So this is one of the important points that we need to check when we are visiting any website. If we are visiting a website, we have to ensure that that website is a genuine one. And this is one of the crucial checkpoints. There might, like, it is easy to encrypt. See, the HTTPS means nothing but the communication is encrypted. That doesn't mean that the site is genuine or site is legitimate. So the HTTPS no longer be a check factor or a trust factor for genuine website. But if we are doing any banking transaction or any authentication thing, I mean, we are providing username and password, then we have to ensure that the HTTPS is there. Even though it's a legitimate website, we have to ensure that the HTTPS is there or not. Because otherwise, that the complete content would be transferred in the form of plain text. Anyone can intercept it and they can get our username and password. Okay. Then come to this one. The facebook.com is actually a subdomain of securitytech.xy. That means the securitytech.xy is the actual domain, and I just created a subdomain. I can create any number of subdomains by using a main domain. So be very careful about that. Whatever website you are visiting, make sure that is the actual domain or that is the main domain. So this is one of the checkpoints. Okay, so this is one example of PayPal, which is a real world example of the one that I just showed you. So when it talks about the phishing, I would like to highlight two major or two important type of phishing, types of phishing. They are spear phishing and CEO fraud. The spear phishing is nothing but they are targeting. The phishing attacks target to a particular group. Let's say targeting only health workers. I'm sending COVID-19 vaccine slot booking related email to only health workers or only to the people who are working in the health department. So I'm targeting the group and customizing the email or customizing my phishing mail and sending to them. That is the spear phishing. The CEO fraud is a kind of spear phishing attack in which the attackers are impersonating or disguising as a director or executive or even the CEO to make the things, okay, or to do the phishing attack. The phishing through phone calls, smishing, the phishing through SMS. This is one example Bhishma already explained about it. So finally, the three things that we have to identify. First, if you received any mail or any website, first stop, they think whether that is genuine or not. Just think about all the factors. Third, if it is genuine, then only move on. Otherwise, stop there. So these are the three main things we have to keep in our mind. So next, over to Grishma.
Okay, tackling the infodemic. So when this infodemic has reached to this point, the area of infodemic management has, 1 second. Adesh, can you please be on mute? Okay, thank you. So infodemic management itself has emerged as a new area of study and research at this point of time, where new resources, new communities of practice are formed around this topic, and new informational resources, educational resources are being developed and spread to the public. And one platform that WHO has come up with is EARS, or Early AI Supported Response with Social Learning, which is an AI-backed platform that is piloted in across 30 countries. So this is the dashboard that you can search for WHO EARS, and then you can navigate to here. Here we can select the area and then the country which we want to see. Here by default, when Southeast Asia is shared, all the three countries are being mentioned. And these are the parameters around the COVID-19 search topics that are being captured and listed by WHO. And how these terms, you know, how much searches or how much lookout for information is happening in these countries around these topics are represented here in this graph. Proportion of conversion, proportion of conversation in percentage, and also here the timeline is updated. So this information is updated almost like daily in that frequency. Yes. And here all the countries are listed. Again, this is the EARS platform where all the countries are listed, and then the parameters, the cause of the virus, stigma around the spread, and all the parameters are listed. So here in Angola, let's see, the cause of the virus is getting a pretty good amount of search. So people are searching for information around this topic, the cause of the virus. Then non-proven treatments. People are searching for different kinds of non-proven and treatments which are not scientifically backed. So this gives an idea or an insight about what are the searches or what are the trending searches or trending things, what people are on the lookout for. So this is very important for some for authorities to know, because there is a high chance around misinformation or fraudulent activities to be conducted around these terms or this capitalizing this lookout for information. And again, this is not directly related to infodemic, but still now many children are online for their studies. So UN Office of Drugs and Crimes have created this online zoo, which has certain educational resources on how to stay safe in the internet. And it encourages children with positive messages on how to deal with the challenges, if at all they need to face online. And they also have downloadable resources in the form of cartoons and all, which they might find interesting to learn. And regarding the social media giants and Google and all, Google has come up with the SOS warning page for crisis. We have seen this page during the times of hurricanes and for COVID also, it is there. So here, the specialty is that it lists only the top priority news and the statistics and relevant information and the authorized websites and all, and not paid ads or SEO content or anything of that sort here. So Facebook has tied up with the International Fact Checking Network to mark the disinformation or false information on Facebook platform. So IFCN is an independent body that is an association of fact checkers, third-party fact checkers. So when somebody, users are given the option to report on a content in any of this this category. So once it is flagged, an independent fact checker verifies it again. And if it is found to be a misinformation or violating a policy, then it is flagged. In that case, that particular message, if it is if it is a blatant violation of policy, it is removed. Or if it has some misinformation, then it is flagged and its further spread is stopped. Its circulation is reduced by Facebook platform so that it would not reach many people. And if at all somebody is sharing, that shared post will also have that flag in them. Okay, so five simple steps of information hygiene that we can follow here is that think before becoming an information broadcaster. That means pause. Then do not trust all information you receive. Then validate the reliability of information and cyber distance, or keep a distance from fake news and sources. And also you have the option to report.
Thank you, Grishma and others.